When do we die? For example, if we rescue a recently drowned person at a swimming pool, even if their heart has stopped and they're not breathing, we know that immediate first aid can often bring them back to life. So if having no breathing and no circulation in that situation does not necessarily result in death, then when can we define someone as dead? What's clinical death? When can we turn off life support or prepare a body for organ donation? Let's start by understanding a few concepts about death itself. Firstly, death is a non-technical word which we appropriately use to refer to the cessation of life in general. It's not reserved for humans. Animals, insects, computer game characters can all undergo death. The word is simply an ambiguous colloquial term. Secondly, it's a biological phenomenon. There's no cultural differences, regional variations, nothing we can say or do that can remove the certainty of biological death. Thirdly, there are only two states, life or death. There's no intermediate or intervening state. This means that there's a distinct point where an organism switches from alive to dead. Fourthly, death is irreversible. You can be in the process of incipient dying and be brought back, but death itself is final. Now, these concepts matter. The moment when death occurs is important, such as determining when we can harvest someone's body parts for an organ donation. A person needs to be dead before organ procurement can take place. So how do we determine the moment of death, and how we determine this is very important in these cases. If we cannot respire on our own, we can still be kept alive on a life support. So what is death? Should we consider it the cessation of the critical functions of the organism as a whole? Or is it simply when we stop becoming human, such as when our higher brain functions, molarity, thought, consideration, become irreversibly damaged? Or is it when our deep brain functions, such as regulation of respiration, reflexes, circulation, are damaged, often called brainstem death? Or is it simply when we can no longer respire on our own? Well, let's look into each of these concepts. Whole brain death defines a cessation of all brain activity and is a satisfying classification of death. But there are recorded occasions where patients devoid of complete brain activity have working lungs and a functioning circulatory system, albeit while on a respirator. So here, although brain death has occurred, to start harvesting organs from this patient seems potentially inappropriate. Even then, what constitutes brain death is controversial. The wide range of techniques used in its determination, including the ability to respire, reflexes such as pupil dilation, facial motor responses, grimacing on deep pressure to a fingernail, and responses to a full brain scan. Now, interestingly, different countries have different requirements for brain death. If we mandated a brain scan for determining death, then hospitals in many countries wouldn't have the resources or staff to keep up with this requirement for so many patients. Of course, for a VIP, president, or leader in society, they would use full brain scans with highly trained specialist clinicians to be 100% sure of all the signs before pronouncing death. This wouldn't happen to your average old man or lady in a hospital. So does this mean that it's harder to be pronounced dead if you're a VIP? Maybe, and it's an interesting concept. Also, just to note, a person doesn't need to be pronounced dead before being taken off life support. If it's a futile attempt to prolong life, complete withdrawal of treatment may be the most appropriate care for an alive patient. Now, clinical death. Most commonly, clinical death is a describing term used to describe the cessation of respiration and circulation. No breathing, no regular heartbeats. This is a term we'd use for the drowned person I mentioned at the start, prior to first aid being administered, because they're clinically dead but can be revived. You may also have heard the term post-mortem cell death or cellular death, but this isn't really a helpful definition. In forensics or pathology, it can assist in determining how long a body has been dead for, but cells can remain living long after a person has died. In fact, in the case of organ donations, laboratory research studies, frozen IVF embryos, a person's cells may remain alive for years, even decades after the person has died under our normal definitions. Even if someone's heart lives in someone else's body, we still consider the donor to be dead, regardless of the state of their cells, tissues, or organs. So, if death isn't simply the cessation of circulation and respiration, and even the concept of brain death is controversial, when do we die? Well, Internationally, it differs and remains still quite a difficult subject, particularly as more and more organs are harvested for donation. However we look at it, in any definition of death, the term irreversible is key.
The irreversible inability to respire or circulate blood will lead to brain death as a certain outcome. So clinical death will always result in brain death if left unaided. So to answer the question, when do we die? Well, it can vary between patients. Most commonly in a hospital setting, someone is dead when the doctor says that they're dead, which is usually after confirming brain death. If there's any uncertainty or without full brain death, sometimes observing the patient for maybe 5 minutes before withdrawing life support is enough to be sure. Either way, it's positive that we have the knowledge of these concepts and classifications that we've considered in this video, and some guidelines about what constitutes clinical death, brain death, circulatory death. However, as organ harvesting for donations increases and more people end their lives in a hospital setting, it's healthy to have these conversations about the controversies surrounding our society's modern definitions of death.